I'm so glad to be here. I'm so excited for this time with you. I know God's going to do some incredible things. He was awesome last night and in this first service, but you've had more sleep than anyone, so you should be even more excited and more energized. I just feel the energy in this room, and I just know God's going to do wonderful things in our midst. Because whenever God's people gather together, that's why the Bible says never to forsake the gathering of the saints, because there's power in the presence of people of faith and people who praise God. The Bible says, "He inhabits our praises." Amen. We had a wonderful praise time. Isn't Oriana in the group doing so good? That's just incredible. It's amazing how much anointing God can pack in a little bitty body like that, huh? Little voice, and she worships so strong. Amen. But Lord, I just thank you for the word that we're going to hear today, Father. I just never take this for granted. Though 30 plus years in ministry, Lord, you have always superseded my expectation. You have always done wonderful things in the midst of your people. And God, we're gathering together. We don't want this just to be another Sunday of just going to church, Lord. We want to have church. We want to experience your presence. And we invite the Holy Spirit to do what he does best. And then what he does best, Lord, is he touches our hearts individually. And so, God, I just thank you for the miracles, the hope that would be rise in our heart. Some they may come in here and they feel hopeless in the situation, that they will leave full of faith and full of strength. And that, Lord, if anyone's here, comes in here and doesn't know Christ as their Lord and Savior, that they will not leave the same. They will know you and know your love, and that you never leave us, never forsake us. And we thank you, Lord. Help me articulate your heart, Father, and speak clearly to your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I want you to take your Bibles or your iPhone or whatever you use to read the word and go to 2 Kings chapter 4. 2 Kings chapter 4. I'm going to try to talk slow, but Micah has given me Red Bull and I've never drank that in my life. And so if you see me just like that, that's why. And then Brian gave me a double shot of espresso coffee. And I'm telling you, I'm wired on water. So when you give me stuff like that, I don't even know where I'm going to go. Last service, I was kicking like Karate Kid up here. And so if I'm a little excited, part of it is that, and part of it is the Holy Spirit. Amen? Our religious folks, Holy Spirit, we'll do that. But I want to take you there as a backdrop to this message. In chapter 4 of 2 Kings, there's a great story. It's one of my favorite. It's an ancient story, but it's a perfect backdrop. And I want to unpack it for you and tell you why the title is the way it is. The title of this message is 3 Days That Will Change Your Life. 3 Days That Will Change Your Life. And I will show you in this story how 3 days in this woman's life changed her life forever. And it's the same 3 days that every one of us will have the opportunity to experience. And let me tell you, these 3 days that you will experience in your life, the way and how you respond to it will make all the difference. And so that's why I believe it's such an important principle from the Word for us to understand. First of all, in this story, it begins in verse 8. It says, now it happened in one day. It happened one day that Elisha went to Shunem, where there was a noble woman, and she persuaded him to eat some food. So it was, as often as he passed by, he would turn into there to eat some food. Verse 9, and she said to her husband, now I know that this is a holy man of God who passes by us regularly. Please let us make a small upper room on the wall and let us put a bed in that room and a table and a chair and a lampstand. So when he passes by, he can come into us and turn there and sleep. And it happened one day. Now let me just stop right here. First day, notice that she has this prophet named Elisha coming through town. And she sees him coming through town on a regular basis. And she realizes that God has got his hand on this man. And she realizes that this man needs a place to stay. I call that the day of opportunity. Say the day of opportunity. Every one of us has that experience in our life, a day of opportunity. And this woman saw an opportunity. Now, there are a lot of people in that town saw Elisha. But this woman was the only woman that seized the moment of opportunity and decided to to build a little addition to her house for this man to stay in so he'd be comfortable. And she decided to be able to feed him. She became a blessing to him and to his life. So often when he would come to town, he would go there. Why? Because this woman was such a, the Bible calls her a noble woman. One translation says a great woman, a wealthy woman, a influential woman. I call her a smart woman. Amen? Because she saw the day of opportunity and decided to seize it and become a blessing to it. Let me tell you, opportunity is always coming our way. You know why I know that? Because you are God's child. And God wants to bless you more than anyone else on this earth. Listen, God's children should be the most blessed, should be the most financially blessed, should be the most physically blessed, should be the most spiritually blessed, the most emotionally blessed. But that's not always the case, huh? We sometimes miss the blessings of God for a lot of reasons. And I want to talk to you about some of those reasons. One of the reasons that we miss God is that when opportunity comes, a lot of times we see it going and recognize it going more than we see it coming. Because a lot of times God's blessing is it comes with overalls and hard work. And we don't recognize it because it's disguised as hard work. And we think God's blessings is just, you know, it's just going to come. It's just going to happen. Let me tell you, you got to prepare for it is what I'm trying to tell you. And this woman prepared for it. It took time to build that little addition to the house. And it took time to get all the things together. She put a bed. The Bible's so detailed. She put a bed there. She even put a little lampstand. She made this a comfortable place for him. She seized the moment. Look at your neighbor and say, seize it. Come on, hit somebody and say, seize it. Not too hard, just smack somebody and say, seize it. We need to seize those opportunities. Anyone ever had an opportunity come in your life and you didn't take advantage of it and you look back and you regret it? You go, gosh, there's been some opportunities in my life where God wanted to bless me. I remember one time a piece of land was offered to me at an incredible price, and I was just kind of taking my time thinking about it, hem-hawing around it, waited for a year before I really started thinking more and more about it. My friend finally came to me and says, you know, I'm just going to sell it, and it seems like you don't want it. I said, well, I do, but I don't know. So he sold it, and then I found out that that property went tripled in value a year later, and I thought, dang, you know, why did I miss that opportunity? And it's so many times like that, you know. God sends you something in your life, you know. Maybe you're a single guy, and God sent you a godly woman, and now she's married to somebody else, and you go, man, I missed that opportunity. She turned out to be a great wife, right? Sometimes we're glad that we didn't not take the opportunity. But we got to prepare for the opportunity, you know. Abraham Lincoln said this. He says, you know, I prepare for opportunity for the chance that when it comes, I'm ready. And I like that. He became one of the greatest presidents that ever lived because he saw a importance to preparing for opportunity and then seizing the moment. Listen to what Proverbs says about opportunities. Proverbs 10, verse 5. It says, a wise youth works hard all summer. A youth who sleeps away the hour of opportunity brings shame. We can't sleep away the hour of opportunity because it is important to our lives. It's important to the next day that I'm going to talk to you. You got to seize that moment. You got to believe that God has sent that your way to bless you. You know, Pastor Mike, you're Mike here because my pastor in Texas is also Pastor Mike. But Pastor Mike Shepline, your church here would not be blessed with him and Pastor Jill if he didn't believe in this principle that I'm talking to you right now. I remember moving. I lived in San Diego with Pastor Mike for many years and Pastor Daniel. I was part of the church there. I remember for many years, Pastor Mike and being in Temecula, California, starting a little startup church with Pastor Jill. And they had all their little kids were just little. I think Josh was not even born yet. And I remember helping him with that little church about 45 minutes outside of San Diego. And we were starting this little church. I was a young evangelist. He was a painter with a painting company. He worked all day, would go in the evenings and minister at this little startup church. And he was preparing himself for a pastor even then while he was a painter. But he also knew that God was going to do something amazing with his life and his family. When I moved here and I took the opportunity to move here and be part of Resurrection Life there in Grand Rapids, started evangelizing through Resurrection Life around the world, I called Pastor Mike and I said, hey, there's a great church that Pastor Duane told me about in St. Joe, Michigan area. Do you know about it? He goes, no. I said, yeah, they're looking for a pastor. And I said, you need to pray about it and really come and meet this board. You know, Pastor Mike came and he met the board, fell in love with this church, fell in love with you. And now what? He's been here how many years? 17, 18 years. Hasn't he been a blessing? Hasn't he been a great pastor? You know why? Because he seized the moment. He took the opportunity and he grabbed onto it. And now he's a blessing to so many people's lives. And now he's back at San Diego blessing Pastor Daniel's church there on this Sunday while I'm here. Let me tell you, if we didn't take advantage of the opportunities that God sent us, we would miss such a blessing. And I just feel like somebody here needs to hear this. God is giving you an opportunity. And you need to pray about it. You need to make sure it's God. And when you do, you need to seize the moment. Be a blessing to somebody. This woman was a blessing to this man. And God opened the door to the day of promise. That's the second day that every one of you will have. And look what it says in her story. It says in verse 11, and it happened one day that speaking of Elisha, came and turned in to the upper room and lay there. Then he said to Gehazi, speaking of Elisha, he said to his servant Gehazi, call the Shunammite woman. When he had called her, she stood before him, and he said to his servant, say now to her, look, you have been concerned for us with all this care. What can I do for you? Do you want me to speak on your behalf to the king or to the commander of the army? And she answered, no, I dwell among my own people. Another translation says, she says, no, I'm okay. You remember, she was a noble, she was a wealthy woman. She had a good life. And so she says, I'm okay. And he said, well, what can I do for you? What must be done for you? He tells his servant Gehazi. And Gehazi says this, actually, she has no son and her husband is old. Elisha gets it. He says, call her back. She comes back to him in verse 15. And he says to her, about this time next year, you're going to embrace a son. Now, her reaction was interesting. She says, no, my Lord, man of God, don't lie to your maidservant. That's a King James version of saying, don't mess with me now. Don't mess with me now. I mean, I'm not a noble woman for no reason. I'm old. My husband is even older. I've wanted this all my life. It's not happened. It's kind of hard for her to believe. But this was a day of promise for her. And let me tell you, one of the reasons we miss the day of promises is because it seems so far-fetched. It seems so out of there. It seems no way that could happen. And she was kind of dealing with that, but the man of God said this. He said, this time next year, you're going to embrace a son. And listen to what the Bible says. The Bible says that after she says, no, man of God, don't mess with me, the woman conceived and bore a son when the appointed time had come in which Elisha had told her. It came to pass, because let me tell you, the Bible says that God is not a man that he shall lie. God, when he says something, listen to what the Bible says about God's promises. It says this about God's promises. It says this, it's powerful. 2 Corinthians 1, verse 20. For all the promises of God in him is yes and amen. Somebody say, God is a promise keeper. That's not just a men's movement back in the 80s. That was God's way of telling us he keeps his promise. Psalms 12, verse 6 says this, our Lord, you are true to your promises. You are true to your promises. Let me tell you, this Bible right here is a Bible full of promises. There's over 7,000, I've heard, promises in this book. And every one of them, God intends to keep them. He has a promise for you. Don't let yourself talk yourself out of it. I remember being in a church like this in Louisiana where I was raised. And A friend of mine invited me to the church, and I was raised Catholic. I never saw hands raised in church. If you raised a hand in my church, the priest would stop and ask, you got a question or something? What's going on? It was just a really quiet, very, very monotonous type of service. And I remember my friend told me about this church that had a lively preacher named Jesse Duplantis. Anybody ever heard him? And so he would come, and he was, we used to call him the Raging Cajun because he was just so funny. And so I went to this church on a Wednesday night, and they were meeting in a tent back then. So I thought that was weird. And they had like a sawdust on the ground, and they had these hay bales for a stage and a band, and a guy named Phil Driscoll was playing the trumpet. And I was like, wow, this is pretty wild church, you know, raising their hand, worshiping God, a lot of young people like you see here on this stage. And I thought, this is pretty cool. And I remember when he preached, he talked about God such in a personal way that I said, man, I want to know God. Like, this guy like talks to God. I want to know God this way. I didn't even know that God was already stirring in my heart. The promises of God over my life already started stirring. There was a moment of opportunity coming where I would be able to be part of this church, and I never even knew that. And I remember a prophetic guy named Dick Mills. I kept going back to this church because there was just something about this church that really drew me. And I went back to it, and I was a gym owner at that time. I was competing as a bodybuilder internationally. I mean, my track for my life was the furthest thing you can ever imagine from ministry. I mean, I was totally in the business world and had no intentions to be anything around ministry. But I loved this church. I loved what they stood for, their vision. I got involved. I started serving in the men's ministry. I started serving in the youth. And this prophet comes through town. And I didn't even know about prophets then, kind of like Elisha. And I'm sitting in the back of the church in the back row, like some of you back there. And God will get you even back there, believe me. Some of them in the back start squirming. Oh, no. I thought I was safe in the back row, you know. And he and this pastor, part of this church, Frank Bailey, he goes, I know we're closing up, but Brother Dick Mills was his name. He goes, there's a young man that just walked in. And he said, James DeMelo, called me Jimmy back then. Jimmy DeMelo, stand up. And you got a word for him. The pastor tells this guy, Dick Mills. I didn't even know the pastor really even knew my name. But the moment of promise was there, the day of promise. And he goes, this Dick Mills, he's very old back then. He's in heaven today. But he goes, young man, stand up. And he goes, and he starts prophesying over my life. He starts saying, you're going to be an evangelist. I didn't even know what the word meant. I knew about priests, right? And I knew about these pastors, but an evangelist. And he says, you're going to be an evangelist. You're going to preach the gospel to the nations. And God's going to use you as a tiger for heaven, is what he said. And I see you leading people to the Lord as many as the sands of the seashore. And he says, and you leading them to Christ. I started crying. Crying, first of all, because I was embarrassed. Secondly, because I was scared. Thirdly, because I could not believe that he was talking to me. I mean, all the things that I had went through in my life, all the struggles as a kid, all the challenges in my dysfunctional upbringing with a father that dealt with anger and alcohol and all the issues that I had as a kid in school and teachers, I started filtering all of that. You ever do that? I started filtering all my past failures. I started filtering all my lack of abilities. I started filtering all the experiences I had with people that were negative. And the enemy came right away, as the Bible says, to steal that seed of promise and faith in me. And I remember saying, God, there's no way. There's no way you can use this immigrant family like you're going to use me, and you're going to use this little Louisiana guy. God, but God says, you know, if I can use that Cajun guy right there, I can use you, James. And, you know, I remember running from God for years, trying to avoid the call of God on my life, but I could not run his promises. Say, he is a promise keeper. He will chase you down. He will find you wherever you are. And when you think it's no way, he will make a way. He will make a way. And you got to be able to shut those thoughts down that are negative. This woman had a promise from God. And she wasn't going to let this promise go away. She said, okay, if it be thy will. You remember Mary, the mother of Jesus? If you ever go and read her story, there's a powerful moment where the angel's talking to her. And he says, you're going to conceive this child. And she's like, I'm not even married. And she says, the Holy Spirit's going to do this. And I love this statement. She says, let it be unto me according to your word. She's like 12 or 13 years old, they estimate. And she says, God, let it be unto you. Some of you need to just say that. God, let it be unto me according to your word. And I remember saying, God, I remember being in California running from God, and I had went through a devastating divorce that my marriage only lasted 6 months. And I'm like, God, what do I do? I remember walking the beach of Venice, California, and now I was all over the internationally known as this bodybuilder, but I fell on my knees and I said, God, I don't want to be a champion for this world. I want to be a champion for you, like you called me to, but I don't know what to do. And it's so scary. I don't even know how to minister in front of people. And more than that, even try to read in front of people. God, remember, I'm the one that struggled with reading in fifth grade. Remember, I'm the one that they made fun of. I'm the ones they called stupid. I'm the one they called ADD and dyslexia and all that stuff. God, I'm giving God all these limitations. But let me tell you, when God is giving out his invitations, he doesn't consult your limitations. He doesn't consult your limitations. God saw me in a way that I couldn't see myself, and you need to see yourself through God's lenses, and this in the word of God. And God said, James, I can use you. I can do all things through you if you just trust me. And I remember saying, okay, God, I walked away from all of that, and I started to serve God. It wasn't too many years later I met your pastor, Pastor Mike, and Pastor Daniel, and we became best friends. And to this day, we still are close, because we've seen what God has done in our life. But it takes you seizing the opportunity. It takes you receiving God's promises. She would have never received the next day that I'm about to tell you that's in all of our lives. And she would have never received the miracle and conceived it if she didn't receive God's promises and his faith into her heart. Because the next day is what I call the day of adversity. It's probably one of the most powerful days of your life, because here, everyone goes through adversity. Everyone goes through tough times. And maybe you're in a tough time right now. Let me tell you, this woman learned to reverse the adversity, and you can. Here's her adversity. Adversity. The Bible says that the child, I'll just give it to you in a nutshell for time's sake, the child is out working with his dad. He's grown up now. Notice the enemy didn't attack when he was a baby. He waited till he grew up a little bit. The enemy will always come in an opportune time to try to steal the promise of God in your life. I'm telling you, you know, 1 Peter 5:8 warns us about that. It says, be sober, be vigilant, for the devil roams this earth like a roaring lion, looking for who he can devour. I like the fact that it says like a lion, but Jesus is a lion. He's a lion of Judah. And greater is he that's in you than he that's in this world. Oh, I'm preaching to somebody. I'm talking to somebody in this place. I got to be preaching better than you. Amen and amen. And so the child has grew. He's working with his dad. And he starts getting a headache. Many think he had a heat stroke or a brain aneurysm. They don't really know. But he starts complaining about a headache. And the father does like a lot of fathers. Go take him to his mama. Go take him to his mother. He doesn't even take the boy. He sends somebody else with the boy. Take him to his mama. And he goes to his mama, and she started to take care of him and rocking him in her arms. And the Bible says she died on her knees. The child died. But what this woman did next in her day of adversity is powerful. The Bible says she lifted the child, the dead, limp body. Can you imagine any mother in here? That's your worst nightmare. And instead of calling for a funeral, instead of beginning the wrapping of an embalmment of his body and ordering spices and all of that, she didn't do any of that. She took his body to the room that the day of opportunity she seized. She took the promise. Remember, that child was the day of promise for her. It was the promise of God. She took it and she laid it on the bed of the man of God, Elisha. And then she did something powerful. And the Bible says she shut the door behind her, walked out of the room, and sees her husband. And he says, what's going on? She doesn't even tell him. As far as I could see in Scripture, she doesn't say the child died. She kept her composure, because I can tell by his reaction. She goes, I just need a donkey and your fastest rider, and I want to go to Mount Carmel where Elisha is. And he goes, why are you going there? It's not even Sunday. Why are you going to bother the preacher? That's how I knew he didn't know. And she says, it is well. It is well. It's the word shalom in Hebrew, and it means it is okay. It's going to be okay. It's all is good. Peace is what it basically means. And he goes, whatever. She gets the donkey. She gets the saddle, puts it on it, gets her rider, and says, don't stop until I tell you. And she rides all the way to Mount Carmel. Mount Carmel was a very important place. Remember, that's the place where God's miraculous power came, and he sent fire, and he took up Elijah's worship, and all those prophets, fake prophets of Baal, were killed. That was a powerful. Mount Carmel was a type of church in that time. It's where the people of God gathered together. It literally means a place of fruitfulness and plentifulness. And she goes there because she knows she needs to go to a place where people of faith gather together and God's miraculous power had been seen. And she sees Elisha, and she runs to Elisha, and Elisha realizes something's wrong, and he sends his servant to go take care of it. But she won't let go of his legs. She grabs onto his legs, and she says, didn't I tell you when you gave me that promise not to lie to me? Did God not give me that child? And he realized the child was in trouble. She says, I won't leave without you. I like this lady. She's holding on to him. I won't leave without you. So he goes to the house, shows up, and the child is in his room. The Bible says he stretched out his body on him and prayed for him. And the child wound up sneezing 7 times and came back to life. And he picks him up, and he hands the live child, the resurrected promise, into her arms. That woman received a miracle on her day of adversity. She reversed the curse of the enemy because she did not give up on God's promise. And maybe you are in that day. Maybe there's an adversity in your life, but I know what that feels like. In 98, when I lived here in Michigan, I just moved here with my young family, and we moved from San Diego. We were living in Hopkins, just about 45 minutes outside of Grand Rapids. And I remember my wife thinking, man, honey, we left sunny San Diego for cold, you know, snowy state like this. God's got to be in here or we wouldn't be here. I said, God's going to do an amazing thing. I remember going to visit Pastor Mike up in northern Michigan, up in Lake City area, and driving away from his cabin there one morning and pulling up around this corner on Jennings Road there, and a semi comes around, a logging truck comes around at 70 miles an hour, and as I pulled out on this blind curve, slams into me, and the next thing I know, I'm fighting for my life. Blood's coming out of every hole in my face. My neck is broke. My back is broke. The engine is sitting on my lap. And I remember taking my last breath and saying, Father, you're faithful to complete what you began in me. I have destiny to fulfill. You see, that moment reversed the curse. That moment changed the direction of what the enemy had planned. He wanted to kill me. And in that moment, it wasn't a coincidence that an off-duty paramedic, the only one that lived in town, saw the whole accident, ran to the car, pulls me out, checks for my pulse, I'm flatlined, and begins to resuscitate me and breaking every rule that paramedics know of and beating on my chest and getting my heart back. And I never forget meeting him several months later and asking him details of the accident. And I said, what was it like to you? He goes, James, it was one of the worst accidents I ever saw. I knew no one survived it. And when I got there, I was right. You were dead. And he says, but I pulled you out, and something inside of me said, this man must not live. It kind of scared me because I heard it in my head. And I started beating on your chest. And he says, about the third hit of your chest, you reached up and grabbed my hand. Open your eyes, and you said, don't hit me again. I don't remember any of that, but he says, you just looked at me, don't hit me again. And you started closing your eyes, and I said, don't close your eyes, I'll hit you again. And I opened them back up. And I said, I'm mangled up enough. And he goes, and you just start talking. You start talking normally. You start giving me your name and your phone number and all of that to call your wife. And I knew that I was a paramedic, and I was doing my job, but something else higher than me was involved in this because you returned so fast. And then I was flown by helicopter to Butterworth there in Grand Rapids, and I began my rehabilitation. Let me tell you, when adversity comes, one of the first things that the enemy will try to do is to rob you of your promise, to rob you of your faith, to bring the most negative things. I learned this from this story. This woman, what did she do? She brought the child. Who would have held it against her to come running out of that house saying, my baby's dead. But the Bible says this. It says on the day of adversity, if your heart faints, your faith was small. Your strength was small is how it says. But this woman's strength was powerful in God. And she laid the child on that bed, the promise. And then she went to the man of God and she says, did I not say, not to lie to me, that this child was coming to me by God? And he said, yes. And he shows up and he reversed the situation. But she shut the door. Sometimes we got to shut the door of the negative talks. Sometimes we got to shut the doors of the people who don't carry the faith that you carry. I remember being in the hospital, and I was so glad that I was part of Resurrection Life. Because Pastor Duane and Pastor Jeannie was so full of faith. Pastor Jeannie showed up on the second day I was in the hospital. And she said, James, God had told me that day there was going to be an accident. And I thought it was one of my children who was coming to visit us. So I prayed over them. And she says, but God said to me that everything is going to be well. Everything's going to be all right. And so I want to just tell you that word was for you. That everything's going to be okay. And I remember sitting in that hospital with a halo, this bolt around my skull and this pad around my chest and back, and all the negative talks. I couldn't feel my legs. I couldn't feel my arms. All the doctors were saying I'd probably never walk again. And I was like, man, I needed that word. You see, God will give you a word from his word that's something you can stand on, a foundation, as we sang today, that you can believe and stand on. But I'm telling you right now, when you read this word and you see what they call a rhema word, that means a word just for you, it becomes revelation to you, then you know you can stand on it. And see, the word of God said, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. The word of God says that greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Thank you for that one clap. Somebody got it, amen? Is there anyone else here? Can I get a clap in the balcony up there? All right. Come on, let's just praise God. The word, his promises, the Bible says he's not a man that he shall live, a lie. He's not a man that he shall lie. But God's word, he's, you know, sometimes we think about all the negative things that we experienced and we filter through that. Let me tell you, God is not that. And I remember sitting in that hospital with all those doctors around me. They could be pretty intimidating with their lab coats and their little glasses, right? Looking at all the reports and all the x-rays. And I remember all these doctors coming in and saying, you know, it looks pretty bad. And I remember saying to them, when do you think I can walk out of here? And they're like, walk? I remember, never forget this. This doctor looked at me with his little beady eyes. And he said, walk. He said, son, I wouldn't get my hopes up. You're lucky to be alive. And I looked at him. I said, luck had nothing to do with it. Come on. It was God's hand on my life. And they said, well, son, I wouldn't get my hopes up. And I said, well, it's too late. I already have my hopes up. It's way up. And my hope is in God. And my hope is in Christ. And I know that he has a plan for my life. And I'm still alive. And God's called me to the nations. I just started prophesying. Listen, I was shutting the door. I was shutting the door to those things. And I had I respected them and I honored them, but I knew there was a greater physician, and they would come in and give me all these bad reports and leave. And several days went by and I still couldn't feel my legs. And I remember one day they all came back in and they stood before me and gave me this report. And they said, James, if you don't get up out of that bed and start walking, then we really, really recommend surgery to your neck and let us put plates and fuse it. And I asked them the golden question. I said, what are the chances of you going in there and doing more damage? They said, well, it's always a 50-50 chance with operation. I said, I don't like the 50-50 chance. I like the 100% chance with God. Yeah. And I looked at my paramedic. I said, you sure have been quiet. What do you think? You're my bone doctor. This has to do with bones. He goes, I put the halo on you. And I say, let's see what happens. I like that. I said, I like that better. And you know, 12 days later, I remember when the doctor said, you got to get up out of that seat. And Micah, I remember telling them, put the rails down. And I remember taking my legs, numb, couldn't feel them, putting them on that floor of that hospital room, bringing my other leg around. And I said, how far do you want me to walk? And I was standing, and I had so much pain shooting up my legs and up my arms and body. But I didn't let them know that. And they said, walk to that door by the end of this room and back, and we'll leave you alone. And I remember it was wobbly, but I knew it wasn't going to be wobbly forever. I remember it was hard, but I knew it wasn't going to be hard forever. And I took a step. It was steps of faith because I couldn't feel my legs. But I got to that door, and I turned around, and I walked back. And they just put their pins back in their shirt and walked out with their little clipboards. And I sat in that bed, and my wife came up to me. She goes, that was great. I said, great. Give me some aspirins quick. And they can get morphine back in me. Get morphine back in me. But I looked at God. I said, thank you, God. And I remember 12 days later, to the shock of everyone, I remember them sending me to a psychological therapist. We call the psyche. And we would go to her, and she would tell me, you got to prepare for a life without walking. And I look at her, and I said, I'm going to walk, man. You know, I've been walking. She goes, yeah, but they're telling me you can't feel your legs, and you're going to lose the use of your legs. It's going to atrophy. And I said, ma'am, I'm going to walk. And I remember I had to shut that door of what she believed in and what I believed in, what God was going to do. This woman, she didn't call for a funeral. She called for the church of God. She went to Mount Carmel where God people met. You see, you need community. I was so glad that I had a community of church, of believers and of pastors who believed and had faith, who encouraged me and said everything is well. Because 12 days later at Butterworth, to their shock and surprise, they would give me literally magazines for wheelchairs for me to order my wheelchair. You know, if I had ordered that wheelchair, I'd be in a wheelchair today. But you know what? I walked out of that hospital 12 days later, and it took me 3 months of rehab. And I remember every day, every step that I took, I worked on it. A lot of times we miss opportunity because, like I said, it's disguise and overalls and hard work. I like to say that the power of God hit my body, and I was completely healed and walked out. But I was taken every day by step. We lived in Hopkins. We had 100 yards to the mailbox. And I remember one morning my little wife walking up there in the snow to go get mail and walking back. And I said to her, honey, I'm going to walk to that mailbox tomorrow. She says, baby, you're having trouble walking to the kitchen. So I'm going to walk to that mailbox. And the church would come around and bring food to us. And the community would come around and help with the help of the house. Pastor Jeannie showed up with a brush and toilet cleaning material. Wanted to help us. My wife cleaned the toilets. Pastor Jeannie of Resurrection Life Church. My wife's like, you're not going to clean our toilets? You're my pastor. She says, nothing's beneath us. You need community. And this woman understood that. She went where the atmosphere was had full of faith. And she grabbed onto that man and said, I ain't letting you go. Sometimes we got to be like that with God's promise. Yeah. I'm not letting you go. Yeah. And I remember the day walking to that mailbox. I got about halfway there and I fell on to one knee because of the pain. And I said, God, I might not be able to make it to the mailbox today, but I'm halfway there. Tomorrow, I'll make it. And I walked back, and then the next day, I got a little further. And then finally, one day, I made it to the mailbox, and I got the mail, and I texted my wife and called her back then. I said, honey, you need to come get me because I don't think I can make it back. But there came a day where I walked to that mailbox, and I got the mail, and I walked back. You think it's such a simple thing, but it was every day. It was a test of the promise of reversing the adversity in my life. Look at your neighbor and say, reverse it. Reverse it. Say, seize it. Say, receive it. Reverse it. And I remember the day I got to that mailbox, I looked down the street and there was a stop sign about two or three blocks away. And I said, I'm going to make it to that stop sign next. And then I made it to that stop sign. Then I saw a telephone pole about a half a mile away. I said, I'm going to make it to that telephone pole. And it was faith steps every day. And that promise came to pass. You know, several years ago, I ran a marathon. I don't even like running. But I ran a marathon. People said, why are you running a marathon? I said, you know why? Because years ago, doctors told me I'll never walk. And the enemy tried to keep me in a wheelchair. I'm going to go run a marathon just to put it in his face. Just to put a Karate Kid chop in his face. And I crossed that finish line. I did it in 6 hours, but I crossed that finish line. The Moldens might have done it a lot faster than that. But I crossed that finish line, and I remember my hands up, and I remember saying, there, in your face, devil. I reversed it. I just ran a freaking marathon. I haven't ran one again. It took me a year to recuperate from it. My knees are still hurting, but I ran a marathon. But I'm here to tell you, I don't know who I'm speaking to as I come to a conclusion this morning. But I'm here to tell you, the day of opportunity, we will always have them. Seize it. Don't miss it. Prepare for it. The day of promise will come to all of us. Hold on to it. Receive it by faith, because it's going to take your faith. I could not believe that God has used me for 32 nations, 34 now. I've been to two nations the last couple of months. And you know, he's still using me. And when adversity comes, everybody's going to have hard season. Maybe you're in that season right now. You can reverse it. You got to hold on to God's promise. You got to get a hold of that word and let the word of God be a reflex. Jesus knew that. Every time the enemy attacked him, he responded with the word of God. The word of God is your strength, your power. It will speak over any doctor. It will speak over any situation, over any lawyer. It will speak over it. Today, I've been married for 27 years to my precious wife, Misty. I have three daughters. Who one is in college there in Hillsong in Australia. The other one's going to Oral Roberts University. Just got accepted. I'm so blessed with my children. I'm so blessed with my wife because I didn't give up on God's promise. And I didn't let adversity hold me back. And I'm here to tell you, whatever situation you're in, he'll do it for you. Let me pray for you. Would you close your eyes and bow your head? Father, I thank you for this great church. I thank you for these great pastors, Pastor Mike and Pastor Jill, and their family, and this staff, Father, that works so hard to give us an environment of faith, an environment of joy, an environment of peace. And Lord, I don't know who's here that's in that any one of those days, but I pray that, Lord, they would learn from this. And Father God, they will apply these principles to their lives. And that, Lord, they will seize the moment. They will receive your promises by faith, and they will reverse the adversity that comes by your word and holding on and closing the door to those words of death and start speaking life, life over them. And so, Father, I just thank you right now for miracles, for marriages to be restored, for bodies to be healed, for minds, some that may be suffering, Lord, from oppression of their mind, that they could be set free. I thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Stay there in that posture of faith. And let me just ask you this question. Maybe you're sitting here today and you don't know Christ in a personal way. You have a knowledge of him, but you have never received him into your heart as Lord. I learned a long time ago, there's a difference between just being Messiah and being Lord. Some call him Savior, but very few call him Lord. Lord is total ownership of your life. That means his will, his plan over yours. Lordship. Jesus said, many will come to me in Matthew 7:22. When I return and say, Jesus, didn't I do all these mighty things in your name? And I will say to them, I never knew you. Because they knew about him. They knew what to do. They knew how to talk. But they didn't know Jesus. I want to ask you, do you know him personally? If you don't, there's a simple prayer you can say. That's powerful. That will seal that deal so that Jesus can say on that day, enter in, my good and faithful servant, for I know you. Say this prayer. Everyone say this prayer with me. Say, Jesus, I receive you as Lord of my life. And I give you my heart, my whole heart. Come into my life and be Lord. And from this moment on, I am yours. Your plan and your will. Be done to me. Jesus' name. If you said that prayer, let me just rejoice with you. Let this church rejoice with you. What does that look like? The Bible says the angels rejoice when just one comes to Christ. And I believe there's more than one. I've asked for 20 people last night in prayer, and several people last night and several people this morning raised their hand, and I know even more in this service. If you said that prayer, maybe you've said it for the first time, maybe you're recommitting your heart, would you just slip up your hand on the count of three, and let me just praise for you. I won't embarrass you. I just want to clap and cheer for you and celebrate with you. Just one, two, three. Lift that hand up. Let me just see that hand. Come on, let me see that hand. I know you're here. I see that hand. Anybody? There's some hands there. There's some hands there. God bless you. In a balcony, I see those hands. I see that hand, sir. God bless you. Come on, give them a big praise. Amen. It took courage. It took courage. You are hearing from God. And so we want to thank you for doing that. And if you're one of those that lifted your hands, make sure to meet someone in this church if you haven't, and connect with this church. Connect with this community. This is Mount Carmel. This is a place of fruitfulness and plentifulness. It's a great staff. There's always a staff here to pray with you. If you need further prayer after church, they'll be here at the altar, and they'll pray with you. There's also a card that you can fill on the outside in the aisle there, or in front of you in the pew. Just fill that out and get involved. Get connected with God's people. You need them. Just like this woman needed Elisha. You need that relationships in your life. Amen. Let me bless you as I often do in my services there in Texas. And if you want to get a hold of me, I'm in Dallas, Texas with Covenant Church. You can get a hold of me at jamesdemelo.com, jamesdemeloministries.com. We have a men's ministry that I'm involved with. We have one we just started called Heroes Return for Soldiers, where we take them for 3 days and we minister to them who deal with PTSD and suicidal thoughts and depression. It's a powerful ministry to soldiers, and including my men's ministry, which is part of The Return Ministry, which is a powerful tool to reach men. Over 1,000 men have been through it, and now we have a chapter here in Michigan, in Nuevo, in Big Rapids area, and now we have 5 states that are doing The Return. It's a 3-day intensive for men. We take 24 men at a time. And it's just been an incredible ministry. And you can get a hold of me at jamesdemeloministry.com, and I'll tell you all about it through our webpage. But I just want to bless you. May the Lord bless you and keep you and cause His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May He lift up His favor upon you and give you peace. And may He cover you with that precious name of Jesus. God bless you, and thank you for listening.
All right. Who was blessed by that message today? Who's got a little more energy to fight the devil today? So good. Thank you. We just thank you, Pastor James, for being here. We want to bless them. The Bible says the laborer is worthy of their hire. So I want to ask you to ask the Lord what He would have you give into James's ministry. Because the ushers will come around in a moment after we pray, and you have an opportunity to give in His ministry so He can keep telling people about Jesus all over the world, right? That's awesome. If you write any checks, you can just make them Road to Life Church. Put James DeMelo in the memo section, and we'll make sure it goes to him. So, Lord, thank you for his message today. It was so good and so timely, God, and such a blessing. We thank you for it, God. And we just pray blessings over James right now. We just pray blessings over his travel, over his family, and all the rest of his ministry that you have planned for the rest of his life, God. And we thank you for what you're doing here in our community, in our church, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.